part, and he told me the story that I just think is amazing. He says the most stressful part was that you're literally, the boats can take you only so far, and then you have to like hike. But there's no land at the North Pole; it's all ice. And so you're camping at night, and you hear this cracking sound. And what the cracks are giant fissures opening up around you, and they could literally open up right where you are with your tent, and you would just fall into the ocean and die. And he says it was like the most stressful thing he'd ever been through. He couldn't sleep a wink for like a week. But he did this expedition with like a famous North Pole expedition guy. And then they have this boat called the Vasa. This is my favorite museum I've ever been to. I've gone to it about three or four times in the different travels I've done. But it's a 64-gun warship Vasa sank on her maiden voyage in 1628. It's the only almost fully intact 17th-century ship that has ever been salvaged. But there's a great story. And again, I'm interested in the stories that have to do with science and technology that I share with my students. And so the story is that, and it was interesting because I heard the story when I first went to visit in the early 1990s, and I didn't hear the story when I went back this time, and I actually pulled the tour guide aside, and I'm like, well, what about the story? Why are you telling the story? And they're saying, well, it doesn't really promote Sweden in a positive way, and we're not really sure if that's true. So it was kind of one of those things, but I love the story, so I'm going to tell the story. So the story is supposedly, and it may not be true, as was pointed out to me, but supposedly there was supposed to be I think there's three decks of guns or something, and so it had two decks, and the king of Sweden at the time says, well, I want this ship to have three decks, but they'd already started building the ship, and the engineer goes, well, no, that's not a good idea, you can't just do that. He says, well, you're fired, or off with your head, or whatever they used to say back then. And so it's kind of like watching Star Wars, when the first guy, the Death Star, gets, he's done with, and the next guy, you're promoted. Are you happy? Oh, yeah, sure. And so the next guy says, sure, third deck of cannons, no problem. And so he builds a third deck of cannons, and he mysteriously disappeared on the day that it set sail, because he probably realized his ship was unstable. It literally sailed out and flipped over and sunk. I mean, this is a giant warship, It's like you go to the museum and they actually have like a sailor's skeleton with like his uniform on, in a display. I mean, it's kind of horrible, but it's at the same time history, and it's just this kind of engineering story where you don't just add a third deck of cannons to a ship unless you know what you're doing. And you can't really do that. And then this was interesting too. This is a model of the solar system that was on the ship. And so they were doing their celestial navigation.
What's the estimated tonnage on that craft?
What's that?
What is the estimated tonnage on that craft?
The size of this thing or the tonnage, I don't know. That's a good question.
It's
going to be enough to say. It didn't sail upside down very well. Then I went to Uppsala University, which is the oldest university in Sweden and of all the Nordic countries, founded in 1477, ranks among the world's 100 best universities. And this is where Adam goes. So he saw his dorm room. It was really fun. I got to see his life. He had his dorm room. He actually worked in a pub. And this is a 400-year-old pub. Like, it's been a pub for 400 years. He's there showing us around. But there was also... Peter Dahlen was an English maker of optical instruments and telescopes, and the Dahlen telescopes were considered some of the finest at the time. So there's some astronomy. I wasn't even expecting to see astronomy there, but Dahlen was there. And Anders Celsius was a Swedish astronomer, but he's not famous for astronomy. What's he famous for? The development of the Celsius scale, which I didn't know this, but was inverted at the time. Today's Celsius scale has been reversed. So it was actually upside down. So the idea that zero was boiling water and 100 would have been freezing water. So a little bit okay, so we're actually finishing. We're getting close to the end here. We're coming back home now. So we're driving back to Amsterdam. And in Amsterdam, I actually visited my former student who designed and is building and selling these astrolabes. It was featured in Sky and Telescope as a new innovative product. If anyone's interested, I can send. There's a video blogger who featured it and did a video, and he's actually getting quite a number of orders. Oh, I should tell you about him. He's such a neat guy. He's got this meticulous talent for meticulous diagrams and drawings, and is fascinated by the mathematics of designing these basically 2,000-year-old astrolabes. But the thing that is interesting is that he was here in the States going to school, and he couldn't afford to stay in the States to do school, but he got some kind of a special scholarship or something to go to Pisa, Italy, where he is now completing his studies in Pisa. And he sent me a picture the other day of a building just down the street from his house, and on the wall it says, Birthplace of Galileo Galilei. So he's literally living, you know, a block down from where Galileo himself is. Okay, so this is funny. Okay, so this is a story. So we're driving down, let's take a look where we are. So we're driving from Amsterdam. Oh, I drive through the town of Gouda. Turns out Tom Rosendahl actually lives in the town of Gouda, which is another cheese. So this is the cheese theme here. That's where Gouda is. And then I'm driving through Belgium, and I'm not really paying attention, and I think it was my son says, "Hey, Dad, I just saw a rocket in the field." "Well, what do you mean you saw a rocket in the field?" I just saw like a giant rocket like sitting in a grass field." And I'm like, "Really?" And so we turn the car around, and there's a rocket sitting in the field. It turns out it's the Eurospace Center in Transien, I guess, in Belgium. It's a science museum and educational tourist attraction located in Belgium, devoted to space science. I didn't even know about this place. I'm just driving down it's not a freeway over there, they're all toll roads that they're charging money, so the non-freeway. And my son, I missed it, my son saw this rocket. But it turns out it was an amazing place, and they have these gravity simulators when you wear virtual 3D glasses, and so I have some silly little video clips that will give you a sense of what we're talking about. So you wear these goggles, and it makes you look, you feel like you're on the moon or something. So you actually think, it's this virtual reality goggles, so you look to the left, and the goggles actually look to the left, you look to the right, the goggles show you looking around the moon to the right, and then you have this kind of like a gravity simulation thing, and they have the world's largest, but they have the largest model of the space shuttle that's not in the U.S., it's actually life-size model of the space shuttle. And then we're in Strasbourg, which is famous for its astronomical clock, and that completes our trip. And I finished things up by taking a close study of UFOs, which is actually a band called UFOs, a famous band from the 90s. And so that was fun. I got to see them play. But so that's my tour of Europe. By 10 minutes, but I hope you enjoyed it. You know, I guess I just want to say, you know, if you have an interest in science, it's not just about going to visit, a museum or something, but it's about an experience, you know, where you're it's an adventure, you're exploring, you're learning, and you're dragging your kids along, you know, that kind of thing. So it's a lot of fun. So, yes, question?
What was the reception touring Europe? Were they very friendly, and how expensive? Exchange rates, and were some friendlier and some ruder than others?
I lived in Paris before when I was a student. I went for a semester in Paris. And Paris is a big city, and big cities, you know, have to deal with a lot of people, and they're not friendly to foreigners as much. But in Grenoble, or in the rural areas of all these countries, the people are wonderful. They reach out to you. They're friendly. Depending on the strength of the dollar, it can be kind of expensive. Switzerland, it was we were camping. I mean, we made this affordable by literally camping. It also added to the adventure. But in Switzerland, just to get a campsite was $100 a night. By the time you did the conversion. So it was interesting. You know, during the time I was there, there was a lot of politics, right, going on in the States.
Election thing.
And so I remember I was in the laundry room, yeah, and a lady spoke to me over and says, and they're all like, what do you think about Trump? And I'm like, she goes, in my country, she was, I forgot where she was from, but she was in my country.
We changed the word for,
I won't say what it is, for Trump. I was like, Trump you, Trump this, Trump. So it was just really interesting to see the political perspective, you know. Anything else there? Okay, well, thank you for your time.
Many thanks to Aaron O'Connor, and I would like to present him with this coveted display.